So I'm Marty Kihn. I work at Gartner. I'm going to talk to you today about what if ad tech and martech don't converge, mad tech no mas. But before I do that, I'm going to do something that I did my first day at business school, 1999, Columbia Business School. We had to say three things about ourselves. One of them was a lie, and you have to guess which one is a lie. Okay? Three statements. Statement number one. There is a show on Showtime until recently called House of Lies. It is about a debauched management consultant named Marty Kihn. That character is based on me. True or false? Anybody? That is true. I wrote the book House of Lies, and that show is based on me, the debauched management consultant. Very loosely based. Okay. Statement number two. I invented a word. There's a word in common use in the English language that I invented myself, and that word is totes. I invented totes. True or false? Oh. All right, that's true. That is false. I did not invent totes. How would I invent a word? That's ridiculous. Another word I did not invent is magotes. That was invented by Paris Hilton on her show Simple Life. Okay, claim number three. And this has to be true if you're keeping track, so it's sort of... I was an early and avid proponent of this phrase, mad tech. Mad tech is marketing technology and advertising technology combined into a nice compressed little acronym. Marketing technology is first-party data and owned platforms. Ad tech is something that you all should know what it is. And two or three years ago, it seemed so obvious that these two worlds that were separate were going to collide into a kind of beautiful collision. And at the fundamental level, at a meaningful level, at the level of code and UI, and companies like Oracle and IBM and SAP would become ad tech players and so on and so forth. And there was a lot of learned commentary on this topic, including, I weighed in as well, AdExchanger, January 2015, ad tech, martech, and the salient quote here is, resistance is futile. First sentence in paragraph two. And it makes sense from the consumer point of view. Think about the customer journey. You know, they go through a relationship with a brand. They start by seeing ads. And we know the journey is not linear anymore. It's more like the flight of the bumblebee. But they do go through stages from awareness to considering you to sort of becoming a customer to complaining to sending something back to getting retargeted to seeing an ad advertisement on television. And it should be all part of the coherent journey. And they don't know that they've been handed off from ad tech into martech into a voice of the customer system. Then they're part of a retargeting audience. That's all behind the scenes. And in fact, if they notice, you're doing something wrong. And from the vendor perspective as well, it makes sense. There are 4,000 point solutions at least. Maybe 4,000 in this room, I don't know. But it's not complete chaos. This is a digital marketing transit map. And you can see there's some organization here. There's the ad ops neighborhood, a social ops neighborhood. There are different tracks. There's an analytics track that intersects with commerce at a certain point. And they all seem to come together around this thing called a digital marketing hub. Now, the hub is not a single vendor, I hasten to say. It's a stack or a state of mind. But it does seem to be real. And people are talking about it. This is the hype cycle. If you haven't seen this, we do dozens of these, but this is for digital marketing and advertising. And it describes the trajectory that technologies go through. And you all know this is true. Something will appear, and people will be like, augmented reality or chatbots or something. People got really excited about it. And like, oh, my God, I got to get one of these things. And then they read about it. And people talk, analysts talk about it, and then they get overhyped, and then people start to use them, and then they become disillusioned because nothing is as great as people think. It's not going to solve all their problems. It goes into the trough of disillusionment and starts climbing out. Digital marketing hubs right now, and you can call them clouds. You can call them enterprise marketing software solutions, whatever. It's a similar idea, are right at the peak. So that tells you where they have to go next. This hype cycle actually works for celebrities, too. That's, who is that? Does anyone know? Come on. Taylor Swift. That is Taylor Swift in 2009, 2010, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Taylor Swift, 2025, at the plateau of maximum celebrity productivity, which is Las Vegas. Then, like an engraved invitation to the wedding, last November, we hear Adobe acquires TubeMogul. Adobe, marketing technology company. TubeMogul, whatever you say about TubeMogul, it's definitely ad tech. So this seemed to be the beginning, a harbinger of things to come. And we thought, all right, it's only a matter of time before we're all hearing bells, getting fitted for our tuxedos, and pricing the fish slices. And then, in the middle of the night, reality calls on a green phone and issues the dreaded words that nobody wants to hear. It's not you, it's me. Or the Silicon Valley version of that, which is, it's not me, it's you. Which is how people break up here, isn't it? I live in New York, and we're like nicer, but anyway. It's not me, it's you, and we're left wondering what happened to this marriage, staring at the phone. Now, if, as I'm going to argue, that the marriage is off between ad tech and marketing tech, I want to get back to our title, They're Not Going to Converge. I want to spend a second saying, addressing this question, what do we mean by convergence? Because obviously something's converging. On the MarTech side, we see quite a bit of convergence. MRM, marketing resource management, email, marketing automation, this has been going on for years. Personalization platforms, content management, are all sort of coming together, coalescing this thing we might call the content stack. And then on the ad tech side, I mean, just look around. There's convergence everywhere. DMPs and DSPs have been together for years. Maybe they belong together. Dynamic creative is kind of layered on top of it. Master profile management is going. Everyone's talking about tag management. And then in analytics, which is my area, analytics, I mean, these were all separate platforms. These are separate line items. There's web and social. Each year, they sort of become more alike. And I think that in 2 or 3 years, my prediction would be maybe one of the big web analytics players will have credible attribution. It will sort of be joined with customer journey analytics. They'll use social data. It'll work for mobile platforms. And you could write open source code scripts on top of it. So there's definitely convergence in analytics. What happens next, though? Does that then mean, logically, there's going to be a next level of Uber convergence, where marketing technology and first-party data and then ad tech, third-party data, sort of come together? As I said, at the level of code, the level of vendor, I mean, to be blunt about it, is Oracle or Krux going to acquire a DSP? You know, would IBM turn their universal behavior exchange into an ad exchange? I don't think so. I'm going to say I think that there are very good reasons, it's very beneficial to both parties, that they remain, ad tech and martech, like parallel roads that go on forever into the future, into the horizon, that don't cross, but they're close to each other. Now, the economic reason for this goes back to this fellow, David Ricardo. You all know David Ricardo? Not related to Lucy Ricardo or Ricky Ricardo. David Ricardo is an 18th century economist. He made $100 million in today's dollars before he was 35. He's very rich, richer than some of you in this room, even. Not all of you. And he read Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations in his late 30s, decided to become an economist and revolutionize economics. And he had this theory of comparative advantage. And as I understand it, this theory says that if there are two countries that both are perfectly capable of producing two different things, they're both better off if they just focus on the thing they do best. That's the primary argument for free trade. And it can go for companies as well. He didn't use hardware and software as examples, but anyway. So I think that if you look at, the more I thought about it, marketing technology and advertising technology as industries, as things, as categories, as entities, and the 8 components of the classic business model, management, cost, product, revenue, competence, customer service, distribution, they are different on almost every dimension. These two things are almost the classic definition of things that have comparative advantage and they're better off sticking to what they do and not combining. Okay, so here's my argument. With me so far? A little bit? Does anyone here have a Bernese Mountain Dog, by the way? Anybody? I always ask this question. Nobody, no. I don't know who I'm dealing with. I just love Bernese Mountain Dogs. So I just like to know if there's someone I would, it's not really relevant. Okay, 6 reasons why ad tech and martech will not converge. And number 7 will shock you. That's called clickbait. I've been around. DR. Number 1, the buyers are different. Who buys advertising? Big brands. It is not a situation. Advertising is a weird business. You all don't know this because you're in it. It is not a situation where 20% of the customers get you 80% of the profits. In advertising, it's more like 20 customers get you 80% of the profits. I'm exaggerating. On a global scale, the top 100 global advertisers spend just a little less than a third of all the media dollars. It's a very skewed industry. You can have a successful ad tech platform and have a dozen customers. Some of you know that. Marketing technology is completely different. There is a word for marketing technology platform provider that has a dozen customers. That word is homeless. Okay, budgets are different. Not only are the industries you're selling into different, but the budgets are different. The people that you sell to, and here I'm talking about the difference between a CMO and a CIO, something we at Gartner are very aware of. So if you think about the marketing expense budget breakdown, there's media dollars, there's technology, and in fact, CMOs and CIOs spend equal amounts in technology, strangely enough. Then there's services like your agencies and then internal labor. I come out of the agency world. That's why I always call labor talent. Sometimes I'll say, you got to hire on some analytics talent or something. And people never know what I'm talking about. Is that an FTE? Everybody has talent. That's what I think. You know. So the media budget is definitely a CMO-controlled domain, or the agency. Technology is not. Even the most progressive retailer, somebody who's nailing it, who's doing promotions and above the line, above the line, and really got digital down, when they make a marketing technology buying decision, it is a hybrid team. It's got people from marketing, people from IT, and others. Legal, procurement. If you've got a marketing technology platform or product, you need a story for the CIO. Now, last time I checked, nobody is asking the CIO if they should heavy up their TRPs on Duck Dynasty. Customer data is different. This one's actually pretty interesting. So, you all know, I mean, I'm not even talking about the PII and non-PII, that's relevant, but on the MarTech side, what matters, the requirements are two things. One is depth, a lot of information, and accuracy. If you're extending coupons to somebody or you're inviting them to join your premier loyalty tier, you want to make sure you know a lot about them and you want to make sure it's real information. On the ad tech side, I don't think that the emphasis is on shallowness. I wouldn't say that, but let's say salience and recency. Salience means if somebody literally just looked at a pair of shoes, you want to know that, or they were just yesterday caught in the vicinity of a BMW dealership. That's valuable information. But you want to know the one thing that matters rather than the 200 things that might matter. And it has to be recent. In fact, you'll trade off accuracy for recency in programmatic. I think, you know, and in fact, the stakes are lower. If you put the wrong ad in front of the wrong person, you know, it's happened before. Talent is different. This one I got in a lot of trouble for because I did an interview with Sarah Sluice to preview this session at AdExchanger. It was called The Marriage is Off Between Ad Tech and MarTech. That Ryan Joe came up with that title, which, you know, vivid. The talent is different, and I said, and I stand by this statement, there is a difference between people who are happy sending emails all day and people who want to meet celebrities. That is the difference between who wants to work in advertising, live in Brooklyn, and someone who wants to live in Battle Creek, Michigan, and work in a basement. Risk is different. This is a slightly more technical, not really. I went to some of those ops talks yesterday, and the guy from SpongeCell really gave me a complex because he was talking about statistics. And like, I got to nerdy up my presentation, but at that point it was too late to nerdy it up. So this is me doing my best here. How do you value a company? So think back to corporate finance. How do you figure out how much the company is worth? And I don't mean market cap. They're not public. Two things. One is cash flow. You try to project cash flow forward. And the second thing is a discount rate. So you discount that cash flow back. And the discount rate depends on the risk. Riskier bets get discounted more, so they're worth less. It makes sense. On both these dimensions, marketing technology and advertising technology are different. Take the cash flow. It's a subscription business in MarTech. It's a monthly payment. It's predictable. I mean, people leave. You can predict how much they leave. Now, ad tech. CPM, okay, Who can tell me what the average CPM for a 300 by 250 banner ad is going to be in 5 years? Who knows? Is Jeff Green here? Jeff Green knows. Nobody else knows. Who knows? I mean, the revenue models. And then on the risk side, there's a lot of things to say here. Ad tech is inherently more risky. Partly it's sort of situational, but part of it's just that advertising is risky. It is. I have ad blocking up here. I don't want to be negative. I think it's maybe an opportunity in disguise. But in general, advertising is more susceptible to changes in consumer behavior. And human beings are unpredictable. I mean, we saw that with the rush to mobile. Nobody could predict that. I know we think we could have by now. Everyone's forgotten this. I mean, this rush to the iPhone. The iPhone's coming out. It's like, I don't know. No one's going to use that. You know, 2 months later, everybody's like, oh, everyone's going to use that. You know, we all need an app. People are not predictable. And then this whole ad aversion thing, it's not a millennial thing, by the way. It cuts across generations. I think it's probably an opportunity, but it adds risk. Another element of risk is the competitive set. So in the marketing technology world, think about the big, I don't know, Adobe Analytics, or your Sitecore, or you work at Eloqua. And you go into a pitch. And I bet, I can almost guarantee, you see the same three or four vendors at every single pitch. In fact, the salespeople know the other salespeople. It's boring, it's predictable, but you know, it's controllable. It's not insane. Advertising, who is the competition in advertising, in ad tech? Who is it? You are going up against the biggest companies in the world. Nobody knows what they're going to do. They don't know what they're going to do. At least they haven't told me, although Facebook is backstage, so they'll tell you in a minute. And they have enough resources, actually, to do pretty much whatever they want. If Google decides, you know, tomorrow, that the future of advertising is body art, we're all going to go out and buy short-sleeve shirts, because it's going to happen. So my point here is this is probably an opportunity also. You know, there are ways to deal with all of these things, including ad blocking. But it adds a lot of risk to the business that's not present in MarTech. Number seven. Okay, secret number seven. This one, as promised, will shock you. Are you ready? Are you ready? Really, anybody? Is anyone ready? Somebody's ready back there. Are you sure? All right, here it is. MarTech and AdTech already converged. What do you think of that one? Didn't see that coming. All right, what do I mean? I'll tell you what I mean. So think about our beloved programmatic landscape. We have the SSPs, we have the DSPs, we got the trading desks, we got, you know, who knows what? Publishers, DCO, we got attribution, we got all kinds of stuff, third-party vendors out there. There's something in the middle that's sort of an organizing principle, and that thing is called the data management platform. What does a DMP do? Three things. A DMP, ideally, and I will admit, none of the DMPs that exist today do all of these things perfectly. Granted, this is the idea. What does a DMP do? It gathers data from various sources, it organizes it, and it makes it available, or as you might say, syndicates it. Look at that column on the left. What do we see in there? Email, CRM, POS, point of sale. What is that? First party data. That's marketing technology data. And it's living nicely beside media data within the confines of the DMP. So I think the convergence is real, and it is happening, and it's happening at this level, the level of identity, the level of audience building, level of data ingestion, and data syndication. And again, I'll say nobody does it perfectly. You need onboarding partners. You probably need some identity management partners, definitely analytics on top of it. MarTech penetration of the DMP category is growing. It is no coincidence that all the big clouds, all three of them, acquired a DMP, most recently Salesforce-Krux, and have more or less started making it the center of their marketing cloud offering. So what about TubeMogul? I'm almost out of time, so I can't really talk about it much, but I would just say three things. One is it hasn't happened yet. They just bought it. Number two, if you look at the Adobe Ad Cloud, it's the TubeMogul cloud, and the DMP is in the analytics stack. So three, I wish TubeMogul well, but I think if it's going to succeed, it will succeed because Adobe keeps it separate. And Adobe is very good at keeping things separate. They have two different companies, if you think about it. The creative company and then all those people in Utah that we love. What happens now? This is a tweetable quote. I thought it was tweetable from Russian playwright Anton Chekhov. I put the info down in the left there if you want to cheat, tweet it. He's dead, Anton Chekhov. He's dead. But I don't know who this guy is, but he's probably used to it. Advertising is the essence of democracy. Advertising is not going anywhere. Advertising is not even going to slow down. It's going to grow. It's critical. It's the gin in the engine of commerce. I made that up. Doesn't really make sense, but anyway. DMP and CDP, this is where convergence will happen. And there's a whole other discussion of what's a CDP, but I think over time, DMPs and customer data platforms look more alike. They sort of become more alike-ish. And where investment and heat and VC dollars and smart graduate students are all going to focus, or should focus, and there may even be acquisition activity from the MarTech clouds, is around cross-channel, ID linkage, that stuff in the middle. Data integration, dealing with multiple data types, classic big data problem, API management. And the hub will function as a kind of a wrapper around it, providing workflow collaboration and execution systems. That's my prediction. Now, you're all wondering, what about ad tech and martech? If the marriage is off, what does that mean? I want to put a positive spin on it. In the spirit of Jeff Green, I just love the positive vibe that he gave. So I'll say it this way. If they're not getting married, they don't have to get divorced, right? And they may end up, actually, in the best of all possible worlds, which is, as we know, thank you.